Hello, and welcome to this episode of Reality Scoop. I'm your host, Shonda D. And today we have a very special returning guest, Jenny Drescher from Bridge to Choice Coaching. Welcome, Jenny.
Hi, Shonda. Thanks for having me back.
Oh, you're very welcome. Glad to have you. So today we're going to be talking about Jenny's move into coaching, life coaching, and what are some of the things that you offer a person with life coaching. Why do we need life coaching? What's it all about?
What's it all about? So a little bit of background about me is that I started coaching about 10 years ago. It's 2017, so wow, 10 years already. And I went to coaching school because along my own journey, I was coached.
Okay.
And I hit a place in my world where I needed a coach. I didn't even know coaching was a thing.
Right.
I was at a crossroads in my career. I had no idea what to do next. And I needed an external source to help support and guide me on figuring out what was really most important to me, where did I want to go next, what were my abilities, what makes me tick, what am I passionate about. So I was advised to work with a coach. A friend of mine gave me that opportunity. She said, here, this is a coach that I've worked with, and try it out and see what you think.
Okay.
And I saw she was getting great results. So I became a coach by being coached.
Oh, nice.
Because I saw the value of it and it really changed my life.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I landed in coaching.
Well, let me ask you, is coaching like a mentor? Is it like a therapist, kind of?
It is mentor-like in certain ways.
Okay.
With certain coaches. Coaching and therapy do share certain features, but they're definitely not the same thing at
okay.
all. So a mentor, if you think of, what do you think of when you think of a mentor? What do you think of the roles that the mentor might have in someone's life?
Well, for me, a mentor is a person who kind of like motivates you. They kind of shape your path with telling you about your progress, if you will. You know, they're kind of like a pseudo surrogate mom or dad.
Yeah. So those are some of the same kinds of things that a coach will do.
Okay.
So that's definitely common ground with a mentor.
Mm-hmm.
I always think of a mentor as somebody who is maybe someone you work with or someone that's external to you, but you probably don't pay them.
Oh.
So a coach would be different in that a coach is usually it's a paid service.
Okay.
Coaching is usually a paid service. And a coach is very often going to give a client much more direct feedback than a mentor. A mentor will do that too. A great quality mentor should be doing that for you.
Right.
One would hope. But a coach is very often the person who is the keeper of the flame, as it will. I always think of the idea that a really good coach should be someone who is always holding on to the ultimate vision for the client.
Okay.
So if the client goes to work with the coach and they say, you know what, I want to create a business where I teach people how to cook healthy food for themselves. It's really easy to get off track.
Yes.
In that, especially if you work another job, which a lot of people do.
Yes.
A lot of people are doing two careers and multiple things. So the coach's job is to be the keeper of that flame. And so that they help that client
to stay focused.
Yeah.
Yes. That's wonderful.
To stay focused. And you may not always see that with mentoring. So that's one of the areas that's distinct between coaching and mentoring. And a coach is also probably going to give that person a little bit more of a push.
Okay.
At least that's the kind of coach I am.
Okay.
That's part of what I do with my clients.
Yeah.
Not every coach is going to do that. Some coaches are much more of the, just sort of, they're more of a guide than anything. I like to think of coaching as, I'm always going to be the subtle hand that's pushing you forward. That you always feel like I've got my hand on your back holding you up and pushing you just a little bit forward.
Oh, nice.
When you aren't pushing yourself forward.
Right. Okay. So then why would you say you're not like a therapist? Because a therapist kind of does the same thing, don't they?
Sort of.
So are you also kind of a therapist?
I am not
kind
remotely,
walking people through their issues and problems to overcome whatever obstacles that they have? I mean...
Right, yeah, like where's the differences in the common ground?
Mm-hmm.
So yes, in therapy and coaching, both a therapist and a coach might do those that exact thing that you just said, okay. Walking people through their problems, understanding what is it that I keep doing that I'm getting in my own way. I say that to my clients all the time. Like, so, what are you doing to get in your own way in this situation? They're like, I'm doing that thing I do over and over again, because we're humans and that's what we do.
Exactly.
And there's nothing wrong with it. It's what I always tell people. It's like, we're all human, we all do it. But with a therapist, therapy tends to be focused more on what has already happened. And it tends to, very, very frequently, therapy is about digging into the past. And coaching is very in the now and forward focused. Okay. So the focus in coaching tends to be in the now and forward, and tends to be less around diving deeply into emotional issues and more into where do you need to be in action? Where can you shift your response so that you can move forward and feel empowered and make different choices and create the thing you're trying to create in the world?
Right.
Whereas with therapy, more often you see, well, let's talk about that thing that happened when you were five and your mother scolded you and it left you this emotional scar. And so it tends to be more healing in that way.
Okay.
So they play both vital roles. I think that I've seen remarkable results in people when they're doing both. I have lots of clients that have walked through that process with them where they're seeing a therapist because they get that there's something wrong in their past that's still weighing them down, that's keeping them from moving forward, you know, because everyone's life is full of that.
Exactly.
And yet they also, they're working with their therapist on not being bogged down by that thing anymore, but they're working with me around shaping what's now and what's next.
Exactly.
And that's a powerful 1-2 punch.
It is.
I love it when my clients are doing that.
So what accreditations do you have?
So there are many different kinds of accreditations in coaching.
Okay.
It's a weird industry. Because it is a weird industry because, well, it's not a regulated industry.
Okay.
So if you meet, I think you've had massage therapists on the show before, right? So they have to, in most states, have to have a specific type of training and a specific license that needs to be renewed. Mm-hmm. That's also the case with lots of other kinds of practitioners. Like, I think you even need a certification to teach yoga, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, you do.
So the weird thing about coaching is you don't actually need required by law. There is no requirement by law for people to be certified, which leaves it open into a very weird space because you can technically call yourself a coach and hang a shingle. So the reason I'm telling you this is because for viewers out there who don't know this, this is an important thing to know about coaching. So where that matters is it's important to look for a coach who has some certifications through the appropriate governing bodies.
Okay.
So there's an organization called the ICF, which is the International Coach Federation.
Okay.
And it is the governing body of the coaching industry. It's the most widely respected, and it's where any coach who has gone through coach training would get their certification. So if you look at the alphabet soup behind my name, it's ACC, PCC, CGC. Which is a lot of gobbledygook. What it really means is that I've been through multiple ICF accredited coaching training programs and passed those accreditations. So those are all certifications that qualify me as a life coach.
Nice.
So there are different kinds of certifications that a coach can get. So for people out there who might be looking at, gee, should I work with a life coach and decide whether that's a good thing? Look for some kind of certification. Because that way you know that they've invested in coach-specific training.
Exactly.
Which is to say they haven't just said, I know how to help people. I'm going to just hang a shingle. I'm a coach.
No,
I'm great at giving advice. No. It's not what it's about.
Well, I'm glad that you you have that distinction and that you're educating the viewers because it's really interesting that anybody can just say that they're a coach.
Yeah, it's a weird thing.
So how long did it take you to, you know, get your accreditation in coaching?
There are different length programs. So the one that I did took me 3 years.
Oh, wow.
So there are some that are, that was 3 years part-time. So there are some that are a year. There are some that are a few months. There are some that are multiple years. It really runs the gamut, and it's also an international industry.
Oh, nice.
So you can travel to Australia to work with coaches and coach training centers mm-hmm. across the globe, do, you know, 1 month intensives with them where mm-hmm. you're just really mired in it the way that you would be with a college program.
Okay.
There are also, you know, we're like any other industry, we have CCEUs and continuing credit programs. So if you want to sharpen up a certain skill and mm-hmm. there's a coach training organization offering that specific skill, mm-hmm. you can go and get those extra credits.
So nice.
It's up to coaches to self-regulate
and
to track that information on okay. themselves.
So. Now, can I ask you, do you have a master coach kind of, or a teacher that you kind of answer to or get guidance from continuously that you know?
Right,
that you work with?
Like, how does a coach get coached?
Yeah.
Yeah, who coaches the coach?
Yeah.
What a great question. I've had a coach since day one. I've had different coaches over the years, depending on the kind of work that I wanted to do.
Okay.
So when I first graduated coach school, part of my certification was to get coached by a mentor coach mm-hmm. who was there to guide me through becoming a coach and the practicing the art and craft of it, the science of it.
Okay.
Having that person be a guide. And so I've actually used her as an ongoing coach over all my years. I mean, after 10 years, I'm pretty much a master at it myself.
Yeah.
But I'm a strong believer that we should always be walking our talk.
Yes, definitely.
And so I think a coach who's not getting coached, I would question that.
Mm.
So I believe always in having a coach.
Yeah,
and I've had this coach on and again, off again for years. And I've also had other kinds of coaches that I've worked with for mm-hmm. other things, like business coaches.
Mm-hmm.
Or right now I'm starting to work with my friend Ellen, who you will not know
yes.
from Connect and Improv.
Yes.
She and I are both working with a leadership development coach as of
nice.
Starting this week. So there are different focus points that you can use a mm-hmm. coach for.
Yeah, because it's good to remain focused and accountable and staying on track.
Yep.
So that's great. So let's talk about some of your success stories.
Ooh. Like, I know, like my brain just went, ooh, what kind of ones do we want to, whose stories should we share? There's so many fun things.
Yeah.
Well, I'm always about being of service to your viewing audience.
Mm-hmm.
So I think at the ones that, at the success story that pops into my mind that would be worth telling your folks about is, I had a client a few years ago who was doing reflexology as a part-time business.
Okay.
And working in a veterinary office
hmm.
full-time. And she loved both of these things and was really struggling with, how can I have enough time in my life
mm-hmm.
to do both of these things?
Right.
You know, she wanted to keep doing reflexology because she loves it. She loves the healing.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you've ever had reflexology.
Yes, I have.
It's pretty awesome.
It is.
And I love reflexology. I'll just say that right up front. Anything that turns me into a marshmallow, I'm all for it. So she was really struggling with time. How does she manage her time? How does she manage her currency?
Right.
Because we all have different currencies.
Yes.
We have currency of emotion. We have currency mm-hmm. of time. We have currency of attention and focus.
Mm.
We have so many different kinds of personal currency. Mm-hmm. And she was expending all of them in too many directions.
Mm-hmm.
So she really needed to work on making more intentional decisions about giving her time and attention and her daytime focus to the veterinary work. She was a veterinary assistant, loved animals,
mm.
wanted to keep doing that work and making a difference in that way.
Right.
And helping strays as part of that particular veterinary practice. She didn't want to walk away from that because she loved it.
Exactly.
She didn't want to walk away from reflexology, but how do you manage that many things and have a sustained marriage and raise two kids?
Wow.
Yeah.
That's really a load.
Yeah. It's a load, yeah.
Yeah.
And so, and plus she had a mom that needed her help because her mom was kind of in failing health at that point.
Mm.
She had owned her own business and needed to really get coaxed into stepping away from the business and retiring because
wow.
it was affecting her health. So if you look at that as not an atypical life for a lot of people. What she was able to achieve, I'm going to, I'll use another name because I don't want to break confidentiality. I'm going to call her Luann.
Okay.
So Luann, this was the landscape of Luann's life and what she needed to figure out. And what she eventually was able to do was to cut back on her part-time reflexology work so that it was in an organized fashion. She was able to decide where and when she was able to focus on it the most and give it the proper amount of time and energy instead of being drained by it.
Okay.
And she was able to make firm decisions about how much time and energy she gave to the veterinary business as well.
Which is very important.
Yeah. So where the biggest skill that she needed to develop that really changed her life was the simplest of things, ironically enough, and it was about making decisions.
Oh, wow.
Because part of what happens to us when we're spread in a million different directions is we're not making clear, firm decisions.
No,
we're not
true.
Saying no where we need to say no. Yep. We're saying yes to too many things or yes to the wrong things or we're scattering that currency all over the place.
Well, I'm going to stop you there because do you think that maybe it's because she's a woman where women are kind of geared toward being yes, 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 yes all the time? Are you seeing that? Because men, they don't have a problem saying no. It's the women who are actually raised to be the nurturers, to constantly be people pleasers, and to say yes all the time. And if you say no, you're kind of looked at as a expletive.
Expletive deleted, yeah.
So do you find that with your male patients that they... I should say clients.
Clients,
yep. Thank you. So your male clients actually can say no more than the female clients?
I'd say historically, that's probably true. I've probably worked with more women who had those kinds of boundary and no challenges and decision-making challenges. I've seen that much more in women than in men, for sure. Although it's not unheard of in men. I think that I've worked with a number of men who did have that tendency.
Okay.
So I think it's probably, you know, personality dependent, just like any of us.
Okay.
So, but yeah, women tend to lean on the yes button a whole lot more than
yes.
they should.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. That's true. So, how did this Luann eventually end up, and how long did it take her to finally start making clear decisions?
Well, it was probably, I'd say, she needed to put out a bunch of fires in her life.
Okay.
For starters.
Yes.
So where we began our work right from the get-go was, let's calm all these fires down. Because what happens when we're expending all of our currencies and our focus in a million different directions is we end up actually sort of starting a lot of fires in our own lives. We get reactive.
Yes.
Instead of mindfully choosing how we want to respond.
Okay.
Or mindfully, intentionally choosing how to expend our currencies. So the first step for her was really about, let's calm down, take a breath, and see what's actual, see what's really happening. And that took her a while to really be able to do that. We were working together three times a month at that time. And it the first couple of months really was about her calming down and learning how to start saying no to stuff.
Right.
And, you know, get a grip on the madness, so to speak, because that's really what it was. That's the position she'd put herself into. And then from there, after the first couple of months, she was able to start making some more intentional choices about where to start saying no. And she started practicing. Oh, okay. All right. I can say no there.
Right.
And the world doesn't hate me.
Oh, yes.
I can say no there, and it doesn't make me a B word. I can say no there, and oh, look, I'm suddenly not a doorstop if I say no there. Or a doormat. Or, oh, wow, the sky didn't fall.
Exactly.
Holy moly. So it's like anything else. You start to do this in little places in your life, and you discover the world doesn't end.
Exactly.
Oh, my God, I didn't die.
Yep.
So, and that takes practice, and it takes learning how to recognize where that's happening. So I'd say over the course of about 6 months, we worked together and got her from needing to put out a lot of fires to really starting to say no in many more places in her life.
Mm-hmm.
And by the end of that first year that she was working with me, she had taken a lot off of her plate.
Okay.
So she had learned how to say no in way more places.
Mm-hmm.
She had started making decisions about what was right for her. She had started to shift in her courage and confidence, which is one of the biggest things.
Mm-hmm.
Because part of why we act like doormats when we're acting like doormats is because we don't have the courage.
Yes.
Or the confidence.
Yes.
And the self-trust.
Yes.
So mm-hmm. all that occurs during the course of working with a good coach. Working with a good coach, you should start to feel more courageous and confident. That's thing that your viewers should know.
Okay.
If they're looking at shopping out for a coach,
mm-hmm.
your interactions should leave you feeling like, okay, that wasn't the easiest thing in the world, because sometimes mm-hmm. we look at hard stuff.
Yeah.
But you should feel empowered, like you can move forward and find more courage and find more confidence.
Right, right. And so I want to ask you, when coaching, do you make house calls? Do you coach virtually? How does the coaching session work?
How does that work? How does that execute? Every coach is a little bit different. My particular preference is I'm a huge fan of Zoom. It's a virtual platform.
Mm-hmm.
Some people I know use Skype. There are WebEx. There's all kinds of different virtual platforms available that people use.
Yes.
I like Zoom just because you can use it on every different kind of device.
Oh.
So you can be in your car and have your, you can sit in the parking lot if you're out in the middle of your errands. I've had clients do this all the time where they'll have the phone and they're like, hey, I'm about to go into the grocery store, but I know we have a coaching session, so I'm parking myself in the car. And I get to see them and I'm looking at all the traffic behind them. It's great. Modern technology is so helpful
mm-hmm.
in that way.
It is.
So I'm a big fan of doing virtual calls. I do have some local clients that I will meet with in person. It's I actually live near walking trails, so I have a client that lives right near me.
Okay.
So we do all of our sessions walking, which is great.
That's nice.
Yeah.
That's wonderful.
So it really depends on the client and where they are.
Mm-hmm.
I've had clients all around the world.
Nice.
So there are certain limitations, obviously.
Of course.
With that,
mm-hmm.
can't coach somebody in California from my own backyard. That's a
no.
little tough. Technology helps.
Yes, it does. It does. So what on average is the amount of time that it takes a person in their mental capacity to get from point A to B and then C, making progress?
Mm. Wow, that's an interesting question. Everybody's different. Everybody's different. Mm-hmm. I would say depends on what their starting point is. Depends on how clear they are on their vision of where they want to be getting going.
Right.
So people who have a specific vision and know where they want to go are going to make faster progress than somebody who doesn't know what they want.
Want, right.
And they're starting at a further back point where they're like, I know I'm not happy with what I've got. Like, I'm not happy with my job. I'm not happy with the amount of money I'm making. I'm not happy with my self-confidence.
Mm-hmm.
But I have no idea what I want to move forward.
Exactly.
That's a person who's much more stuck.
Yes.
As opposed to somebody who has a specific vision, like Luann did, where she said, you know what? I really want these things to be balanced.
Mm-hmm.
So her vision of success for herself was, I need to put these things into balance so that I can do both of them without killing myself or neglecting my family.
Exactly.
That was her specific vision.
Mm-hmm.
So a good coach should help you to be able to move forward from where you are.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, I mostly work with people who know what they want already.
Okay.
And so I work with people to help people get to that vision, get out of their own way. Break their patterns, push past their shoulds, because
mm-hmm.
shoulds are somebody else's property. We could have a whole conversation
yes.
about that. But really working with people around crafting it and moving forward and getting out of their way.
Mm-hmm.
There are coaches who specialize in helping people figure out what they want in the first place. Not my deal. I'm not really, that's not my forte, but I know people who do, where they're really, that's their sweet spot in coaching is
mm-hmm.
helping people in that discovery process of what do I want?
Want?
What do I want to be when I grow up?
Yeah.
Or what's important to me? What am I passionate about?
Some people just still haven't figured it out.
Yeah. Well, and we are living in the age of opportunity, so it can be hard to
yes,
know.
Yes, to decide.
It's a weird problem to have.
Yeah.
It's a very modern problem.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, it's been great to have you. That's all the time we have for today.
Fun.
So I want to thank you, Jenny Drescher from Bridge to Choice Coaching. Are you on Facebook?
I am. Yep. I'm easily found under Jenny Drescher. I do everything under my own personal page.
Okay, wonderful. Yep. Are you on Twitter?
I am not on Twitter. Nope.
Instagram?
I am on Instagram.
Oh,
yep.
Wonderful.
I'm on Instagram as Connect and Improv.
Oh, very nice. And so I want to thank Jenny for being here today on Reality Scoop. Until next time, I'm Shonda D. signing out.